In this video, we will study about the classification of the animals called non-chordates. The five kingdom method of classification. We will also study the new method or system of classification, benefits of classification, the whole non-chord data, and classification as per body organization, symmetry, and the presence or absence of body cavity. Living organisms are classified according to a five kingdom system proposed by Robert Whittaker. Living organisms are divided into two subgroups depending upon their cell, whether they are prokaryotes or eukaryotes. Prokaryotes belong to the kingdom Monera, the first kingdom. Eukaryotes are further divided into multicellular organisms like the elephant you see here, or unicellular organisms like amoeba. Now, these unicellular organisms having eukaryotic cell belong to the kingdom Protista, whereas the multicellular organisms are again subdivided into those having a cell wall and those without a cell wall. Now, those having a cell wall are classified according to feeding habits, that is autotrophs, which prepare their own food, and heterotrophs, which do not prepare their own food but make use of food from outside. Okay. So autotrophs give us the third kingdom. They form the third kingdom called plantae, whereas heterotrophs with cell wall give the next kingdom called fungi. Now, those multicellular organisms without cell wall give us the fifth kingdom, which we are going to study about in this video, that is kingdom Animalia. So the five kingdoms, Monera, Protista, Fungi, Plantae, and Animalia, as given to us by Robert Whittaker. What is animal classification? Formation of groups and subgroups of animals depending upon the similarities between them and the difference among them is called animal classification. That is just putting animals into groups. Now, for what reason? Why does this benefit us? Is because the study of animals then becomes convenient. Okay, a study of a few animals, if we study a few animals from one group, it helps us to understand about all the animals in that group. It also gives us an idea of how animals evolved. Animals can be easily identified with great accuracy. It also helps us to understand the relationship of animals with other living organisms, and also to understand the habitat or the place, like a terrestrial aquatic place where the animal lives, and what is the role of that animal in nature, and also to understand how each animal has adapted to nature. A very important diagram showing us kingdom Animalia, two subkingdoms, non-chordates and chordates. And after the subkingdom, these non-chordates are broken into 10 phylums or subdivided into protozoa, porifera, nidaria or coelenterata, platyhelminthes, ashelminthes, annelida, arthropoda, mollusca, echinodermata and hemichordata. 10 phylums making up this subkingdom non-chordates. And then we have chordates, which have only one phylum, that is chordata, broken up into three subphylums, urochordata, cephalochordata and vertebrata. And this phylum, subphylum, vertebrata, again subdivided into six classes called Cyclostomata, Pisces, Amphibia, Reptilia, Apes, and Mammalia. Animals are again put into various subcategories depending on whether their body organization is only as, you know, very low level body organization or the cellular grade, or they are higher organisms or more developed, having tissue, organ and organ system grade. The body symmetry is the next division, where you see there are three types of symmetry here: asymmetrical, radial and bilateral. Then the body cavity, whether the animal has a cavity or doesn't have a body cavity, according to that we have three categories, that is acoelomate, pseudocoelomate and eucoelomate. And finally, it shows you which phylum has all these categories, belongs to all these categories. Like if you see Porifera is acoelomate, it has an asymmetrical body and it is cellular grade. Whereas Cnidaria is acoelomate, having radial symmetry, and it can belong to any one of this, either tissue, organ or organ system grade. Platyhelminthes, acoelomate, having bilateral symmetry. Ashelminthes, pseudocoelomate, bilateral symmetry. And then right from Annelida onwards to Chordata and forward, we have all the phylum, the animals belonging to these phylum, eucoelomate, having bilateral symmetry and having tissue, organ or organ system grade. Further studying about the criteria used for classification, we first come to symmetry, where we have three types of symmetry. The first picture of the cockroach showing you bilateral symmetry, meaning if the cockroach is divided from the center, the axis, imaginary line which is dividing it from the center, we can get this cockroach or other organisms into two equal halves. Now, such type of a symmetry is bilateral symmetry. The second one, when we have a cylindrical organism, any axis can be used to divide it into two equal halves. That is called radial symmetry. And then we have animals like sponges and amoeba, which have no proper shape. And you can use any axis, either from the center or any other side, and you will not get the animal in two equal halves. That shows the animal is asymmetrical. So three types of symmetry: bilateral, radial and asymmetry. Then classification on whether the animal is diploblastic or triploblastic. Now, diploblastic meaning having two germ cell layers, only ectoderm, which is outside layer, and endoderm, which is in the center, and they have another layer in the middle of ectoderm and endoderm, but it's not important because it's a non-living layer. A triploblastic organism is having three germ cell layers, that is the inner endoderm and the outer ectoderm, similar to diploblastic, but they have a middle mesoderm, which makes it triploblastic. Then the organisms divided on whether they have body cavity or coelom or not. So there we have three subcategories: acoelomate, meaning no central body cavity. Now, body cavity is a cavity in which, you know, the visceral organs, that is the systems, the digestive system, respiratory system and all are all there, separated from the rest of the body. So that's called a body cavity. So acoelomate animals have no central body cavity. Pseudocoelomate have a make-believe or not a true body cavity, a false body cavity. Okay, and eucoelomate have all the three germ cells, that is triploblastic, I mean they are triploblastic, and they can be said to have a body cavity. The first phylum, protozoa. These are some organisms like you have heard about Euglena, amoeba, paramecium, which come under protozoa. They live in a wide variety of habitats, freshwater, seawater or marine environments and soil, and they are come in various shapes and sizes, from amoeba, which is a single cell, to paramecium with a fixed shape, and often they are grouped in the kingdom Protista. Phylum Porifera or sponges. They have a simple body plan called sponges, and they bear pores, as you can see in this diagram here, called ostia and osculum on the top. They are aquatic animals living in water. Few are fresh water, but mostly marine, meaning living in the sea, salt water. The body is mainly asymmetrical, and they have special collar cells which give these ostia and osculum some kind of support. Now, these sponges are always attached to a substratum, meaning a rock or a piece of wood. They don't show locomotion or movement, and hence they are called sedentary. See here at this animal attached to a wooden stick. Now, their body is spongy and supported by spicules or sponging fibers made up of calcium carbonate or silica, which gives a little support to their soft spongy body. They feed on small organisms taken in with water. Now, if you see these pores over here called ostia, the water goes inside along with water. Small living organisms also go there. The water is released through the osculum on the top of a ear. But the living organisms serve as the food of sponges. They reproduce by budding, which is an asexual method, or bisexual method, and they have a good ability for regeneration, meaning if some part of it is broken, they will immediately, you know, form in a very fast rate more and more cells and see that that body part which is broken off is repaired and comes back again. And these are the examples: Cycon, bath spawn or eusponger, Halonema, Euplectella. We have phylum Cnidaria. These are the examples: Hydra, Aurelia, which are cylindrical in shape. You can see them cylindrical, which are called polyps, and the umbrella shaped ones, which are called Medusa, umbrella-shaped examples of corals. Mostly, they live in seawater or marine, and a few of them live in freshwater. The body is radially symmetrical because they are cylindrical, and diploblastic, meaning made up of only two germ cell layers. Now, nidoblasts, they are containing secretory cells, and they sting. They have tentacles. See these tentacles here, these long structures around the mouth, which not only help to capture their food or the prey, but they are also for protection, because if they find there is any danger, they inject the prey or the dangerous thing with toxins or poisons. Example: Hydra, Adamsia, Physalia, Aurelia, jellyfish or corals. Next we come to Platyhelminthes, also known as flatworms, tapeworms and flukes. Now, they have a slender and flat body like a leaf, as you can see with liver fluke. Most of them are endoparasites, meaning they live off the nutrition of the host. They don't make their own food. They just suck whatever is there from the host. Now, endoparasite means they live within the body of the host, while few of them are free living and they live in water. Their body is acoelomate, meaning having no body cavity, and bilaterally symmetrical. Then they are triploblastic, that means having three germ layers, all three, endoderm, ectoderm and mesoderm. And these animals are hermaphrodite, meaning the male and the female reproductive systems are in the same body. They don't have separate female and male, and that is called hermaphrodite. The next phylum, Achelminthes or roundworms. The body of these animals is long, thread-like or cylindrical, and hence they are called roundworms. This is the diagram of Ascaris. Male has a curved tail, very simple body structure. They are either free living or endoparasitic, that means they live within the host. And they, if they are free living, they are water, in water or on land. Now you can see the lower worm, the worm in the eye here, endoparasite. The body is triploblastic and pseudocoelomate, meaning they don't have a true body cavity. The body is non-segmented, meaning it is not divided into segments, and covered with a tough cuticle. A cuticle is a tough substance, like how we have the nails of our, in our, on our fingers and toes. They are made up of cuticle, a hard substance which gives support to the body. And they are unisexual animals, meaning they have separate male and female. Another example is the filarial worm, and this worm is another endoparasite, and this is what it causes in human beings when it enters into and becomes an endoparasite. Phylum Annelida. The body of these animals is long, cylindrical and metamerically segmented, means if you look at this diagram over here, you will see that there are segments. These parts are called segments. Okay, this is a figure of an earthworm. Metamerically segmented means those segments will be repeating in their pattern. A few group of segments and the same group of segments. So they are metamerically segmented. And if you can see, the earthworm is fully segmented, but it has a portion in the middle of its body which is unsegmented or non-segmented, and that is called the clitellum. Most of them are free living and they live either in marine or sea water, fresh water or are terrestrial. Few of them are ectoparasites, meaning like the leech, you know, they live on the host of the body of the host from outside, not from inside the body. They are triploblastic, bilaterally symmetrical and eucoelomate, meaning they have a body cavity. And like shown in this picture, setae, these structures are called setae. So they use these setae, or parapodia or suckers, for movement or locomotion. The body is covered again with cuticle, which is a little hard substance. And these creatures or organisms or animals are either hermaphrodite, that means they have the body, the male and reproductive, female reproductive system in the same body, or they can be separate male and female. That is called unisexual. Arthropoda, very, very interesting phylum, because they are the largest phylum having successful animals, found even in the deepest oceans and the highest mountains. And the main characteristic of this phylum is that they have jointed appendages. Appendages meaning extra parts of the body, like how we have our hands and legs which are, you know, attached to the main body. So anything that is outer which is attached to the main body are called appendages. And our hands are separate, but these arthropods, like, you know, the spider and the cockroach, they're both, their legs are joined together and they move in separate right and left directions. Okay, now the body of these animals is triploblastic, Eucoelomate meaning having body cavity, bilaterally symmetrical, segmented, they are unisexual meaning they have male and female. Chitinous exoskeleton is present, like in the form, in the case of cockroach and scorpion, you see how hard they are. Okay, that is because of the chitinous exoskeleton, skeleton which is outside the body. Okay, so they have a hard structure all outside the body. And these are the examples. Okay, crab, see the different types. You have insects, worms, as well as water animals, all coming under the phylum Arthropoda. And these are just jointed appendages where their legs are joined, but they come in separate directions. Next is the second largest phylum in the animal kingdom, and that is Mollusca. Okay, the body of these animals is soft and slimy, as you can see with the octopus, with oyster, the bivalve which you get in between the shells, the snail, soft slimy body. They are either aquatic or terrestrial, that is living on land. Mostly they live in seawater, but a few of them also live in freshwater. Their body is triploblastic, eucoelomate meaning having cavity, non-segmented, soft, and all of them show bilateral symmetry except the snail. Now these animals, slightly higher animals, have the body divided into head, foot and visceral mass. I told you visceral mass is the mass of the respiratory digestive systems within the body. And this visceral mass is covered with a mantle. Mantle meaning a covering which secretes a hard calcareous shell. This shell may be present, absent or internal in some cases, and these animals are unisexual. Now these calcareous shells are made up of calcium carbonate to give body hardness to their body, soft body structure. The next phylum is Echinodermata. They also have calcareous spines, hence they are called Echinodermata. Look at this creature here, sea urchin, full body made up of spines. They are found only in oceans, not freshwater. Body is triploblastic, meaning made up of three germ layers. Eucoelomate meaning having a good body cavity. Radially symmetrical because they are cylindrical organisms when they are adult. And when they are in their larva stage, their growing up stage, they show bilateral symmetry. Now, these animals use tube feet for locomotion. If you look here, you can see in this starfish, there are little structures here called the tube feet used for locomotion or moving and for capturing their food or their prey. Now, their skeleton is made up of calcareous spines or ossicles in the form of plates. And these animals also have a good ability to regenerate or make up their body parts if they are damaged, and they are mostly unisexual. Next phylum, Hemichordata. Here, the unique characteristic is that the body is divided into proboscis, collar and trunk. As with this example called Belanglossis, you see the top structure called the proboscis, which is in the shape of a fruit called acorn, and therefore they are called acorn worms. Okay, so proboscis, after which comes the collar and then the whole trunk of the body, and they have given you a look into the internal part of the body also. Okay, now notochord, or the beginning of a spinal cord, is seen in this proboscis region. So they are called hemichordates. Okay, they are marine, or they live in burrows in the sand, and because of their shape they are called acorn worms. Another example, they have one or many pharyngeal slits for breathing. They are unisexual, but a few of them are hermaphrodite. Now, this is a very, very important phylum, because Balanglosis, that is one organism of this phylum, is considered to be a connecting link between chordates and non-chordates. Now, we have learnt of evolution, we learnt of peripatus, how it shows the properties or characteristics of Annelida and Arthropoda. So it's in the middle, you know, it's in the middle of Annelida and Arthropoda, it's in the process of evolution. In the same way, Balanglosis, it shows a small notochord, which is the characteristics of chordates, not non-chordates. But the other characteristics it shows belong to non-chordates. So as of now, it comes under non-chordata. But because there is a beginning of a notochord, which is a little spinal cord, they are in between chordata and non-chordata, and hence they are called hemichordates. Now, here I just given you all the phylums at one glance. Okay, the portion of symmetry, coelom, segmentation, and digestive system is omitted from your portion. But unless you know what radial, bilateral, and pseudo-coelomate means, you will not be able to write the characteristics. So these will not come for your exam, but for understanding the entire phylum, I've given you this table here, so quickly you can see what are the distinctive features, what kind of symmetry, what level organism, what kind of cavity it has. These things can be seen by you and revised easily. And we will continue about phylum Chordata in the next part.